Hi, my name's Nico, and this is my backyard observatory, and in this video, I'm going to show you how I built it.
I started by marking out the footprint of my planned 10 by 14 foot building, and used wooden stakes, string, and a measuring tape to figure out precisely where to dig holes to put in the isolated telescope piers. I then dug the holes using a post hole digger and a pry bar to get out all the big rocks. Once I had dug the holes below my frost line, which for my location was 4 feet down, I filled the holes with concrete and rebar, and then used cardboard sonotubes and some wood bracing and kept the concrete going above ground to make the telescope piers. With the concrete still wet, I sunk in some metal pier plates I bought from Dan's Pier Plates that will allow me to easily attach my telescope mounts. After a few days, I ripped off the cardboard form, leaving the completed telescope piers. For the foundation, I had two options for my location, a concrete slab with a haunch foundation, or for the building to sit on several structural piers of concrete. I opted for the latter as it meant that I could do all the work myself more cheaply and not have to hire contractors. I dug 6 holes for the building and 2 holes for the end of the roof extension, 8 holes total. In each hole, I put a large sonotube and filled it with concrete and rebar. I then dug out the rest of the building's footprint and filled it with crushed stone. The purpose of this was to keep moisture levels down and prevent wildlife from wanting to make their home under the building. With the groundwork complete, I started building the floor. I started by securing post bases to the structural piers using concrete anchors. I then created floor beams with treated lumber and nailed the beams into the post bases. I then laid out floor joists, which were also treated wood and blocking, and nailed all of this together. On top of the floor joists, I glued and nailed on treated plywood sheets to finish the floor. Around the piers, I made some rough custom pieces of plywood using a handheld router. With the floor completed, I did the all-important vibration test to see if my telescope piers were truly isolated from the floor, and I was glad to see they passed. Next up, you would think I'd build the walls, but instead I used this opportunity of having a nice open floor to build my roof trusses. For my roof, which is 14 feet long, I built 11 trusses, and I built them at a slope of 12.5, meaning for every 12 inches in from the edge, the roof rises 5 inches. With the trusses done and stored in my garage for later, I turned to the wall framing. I used pretty standard construction here, building the walls from 2x4s, 16 inches on center. You do want to think through how tall you want your walls, and for my location and preferences, 6 feet 8 inches made sense. After constructing and putting up framing for the walls, I installed sheathing to finish them. For the sheathing, I used LP smart panels, which are OSB that already have an exterior finish on the outside that you can paint on directly. I cut out rough openings for the door and the windows and installed the smart panels with glue and nails. Since I was working by myself, I used a combination of temporary screwed-on wood blocks and clamps to get the panels into place before securing them with the nailer. I then moved on to building the wood extension that would hold the roof when it rolls off of the building. I had already put in some concrete piers earlier, so now I just installed the post bases using concrete anchors again, and for the end posts, I put them up temporarily to mark out the correct height for the beams and then cut out notches for the beams to sit in. With the posts up, I then built some very heavy beams out of doubled up 2x10s on each side. They were so heavy that I built them on top of scaffolding so they would be easier for me to secure to the building and to the end posts all on my own. With the extension beams in place and secured with a variety of nails and screws, I beefed up the extension with cross braces and knee braces. With the extension done, I added in a door and windows. These were all pre-hung products that were pretty simple to install. For the roof to roll off, you need tracks and wheels of some kind, and there are a number of different ways to do this, but I went with garage door tracks, brackets, and wheels that I bought directly from a garage door supply company in Boston. Before I screwed on the tracks, I drilled out some holes in the bottom so that water and snow would drain more easily. I then screwed on the tracks and made the rolling platform that would act as the base of the roof. If you're watching this and thinking, this is awesome, I'd like to put in an observatory in my backyard, but there's just no way I have time to build one myself. Well, I have great news for you because the sponsor for today's video, Stoltzfus Structures, will custom build one for you and deliver it. They call it their Stargazer Shed. And in fact, the Stargazer Shed was largely the inspiration for how I designed mine. I visited my friend Jay Sottolano back in 2022, and I was really impressed by his observatory, and he told me about Stoltzfus and how great it was to work with them on it. When you work with Stoltzfus Structures, you can really design the observatory however suits you, from colors to finishes to warm room additions. They offer sizes anywhere from 8x8 feet, which would be good for a single pier, to 12x14 feet, which would be good for 2 piers. And there are huge advantages to having your astronomy gear permanently set up in an observatory. Whenever it's clear, instead of having to take lots of time setting everything up, with the Stargazer shed, all your gear is already set up inside, and you just press a button, the roof rolls off of the commercial garage door motor, and you're observing or imaging within minutes. You can also rest easy knowing your gear is perfectly safe from the elements, because each Stargazer shed is built with true Amish craftsmanship, using the same materials you expect in your home, like a normal exterior house door, vinyl siding, and a metal roof rated for 40 years. But don't just take my word for it. Here's a few quotes from happy customers. James says, "I ordered a sky shed for my telescope. These folks were extremely professional and responsive throughout the entire process. They delivered my custom shed ahead of schedule, and the installation was top notch." Sheila says, "Everyone we talked to was very helpful and pleasant. I love my shed already. Got to see the night sky, meteors, star clusters, and a satellite. The roll-off roof runs smoothly." And Brian says, "These guys are the best, true craftsmen in an age in which that is becoming increasingly rare." So if you're ready to take the next big step and design your own Stargazer shed, click the link in the description to get a quote for your dream backyard observatory. With the roof platform rolling smoothly, I now is ready to add the previously built roof trusses one by one. When all the roof trusses had been added, I added some long cross pieces called strapping. This is what the metal roof will screw onto. And then I added some thinner fascia boards to each edge. On the short ends, I marked and cut out some more pieces of the LP smart panels that I'd used for sheathing on the walls, and included a small square cutout for some gable vents to improve air circulation. I then added some blocking to close off the framing on the roof, and then stapled some double bubble foil insulation onto the strapping. Since the whole roof is on wheels, I screwed on some temporary bracing to keep it from moving while I was adding the metal roofing. The metal roofing goes on in panels with self-drilling screws that have rubber washers pre-installed to keep out the water. If you need to cut your final panel, I would suggest using a circular saw with an old blade installed backwards. Use an old blade because this method will wreck the blade, but I find this way much easier than using tin snips. With all the panels up, the next step is screwing on the trim pieces onto the gable ends, and then finally the ridge cap at the top. The screws that came with my roof were too short for the ridge cap, so I was putting on the ridge cap late into the night after getting some longer screws from Home Depot. I needed to get it done that night as a big snowstorm was coming. But with this metal roof on, the observatory was now functional, so I took a break from making more improvements until the weather got warmer. I could keep my gear inside and push off the roof anytime I wanted to start taking photos. Here's some of my first pictures that I took from the observatory. Once summer hit, I painted the observatory to match my house, and I added some flower boxes under the windows for a bit of aesthetic beauty. I then hired an electrician to extend electricity from my house to the observatory with a 60-amp sub panel. With the sub panel installed, I made a plan for how to safely add outlets and lights to the observatory. Since the roof can open and then you're open to the elements, you want everything to be outdoor rated and have each electrical circuit protected by a GFCI. Instead of GFCI breakers, I used a GFC outlet as the first outlet in each circuit. The outlets are protected from moisture since each one is inside a plastic weatherproof box. I also went for vertical outlets at each telescope pier supported by some pegboard. For the lights, I did two switches so I could have one set to red and one set to white, but each bulb is also dimmable because I used Philips Hue smart bulbs that can be controlled over Wi-Fi through an app. Lastly, I installed security cameras so I can keep an eye on things even when I'm not in the observatory. Most nights I come out and I get things started, and then I enjoy the night sky a bit visually and then go to sleep and close up the roof in the morning. So far this has worked out great, but there are a couple items that I'm saving for. One is a motor and controller for the roof. I really don't mind pushing it off manually, but if I motorize the roof, then I can also hook up rain and cloud sensors so that the roof can close automatically if it senses that it's about to rain. This would give me some, you know, just extra peace of mind when I go to sleep with the roof open. Every observatory has to have a name, and often they are location-based, and mine is too, but in a tricky way so it doesn't give away exactly where I am. My observatory is called the Paper Birch Observatory. To be honest, there isn't too much I would have done differently in terms of the design of the Paper Birch Observatory. Of course, I gained lots of building experience, so if I were to do it again, I would make fewer mistakes for sure. But overall, I'm very happy with my observatory build, and it's just so useful. For the longer version of this build process with much more detail, you can refer to the original series of videos, which I'll link in the description. And don't forget about Stoltzfus Structures and their Stargazer shed if you want someone to build an observatory for you. and I'll just leave you here with a few more images I've taken from the observatory. Thanks for watching, and clear skies.